to Classic Screenshots. I'm your host, Henry Cameron Allen. And
I'm QueenB Divine. Welcome!
We're so happy that this amazing artist, Nina Paley, who I have to tell you, Nina, the first time that I became aware of you and your work was your Copying Is Not Theft video. Which it just struck me as permission to just be an artist and be inspired by everything that came before. And we're going to get into that, but I want to welcome you so dearly to this forum because you are truly one of my sheroes.
Aww.
I have to say, you really, really are. So this is a dream come true that you said yes to this. And thank you.
Well, thank you for having me.
Well, you know, I just want to pop in and say I'm a baby fan. I'm just birthed into the Nina experience, I tell you. It's delicious. And by the grace of Henry here, who sat me down and said, you've got to see this movie. I was just blown away by your creativity and how you're capable of just working around everything and just putting your magic into it without changing anything. You know what I mean? It was just brilliant. I just loved it. So I just want to say I'm newly on board, but I love you, darling. I love you.
Thank you, Queen Bee.
When did this whole thing begin? You did comics before, right?
Yeah. I mean, I was a very determined and ambitious young artist. And I don't have that drive now. I just don't. I think like, man, I was arting like my life depended on them. Anyway, my experience of being a child was that all the other kids also were into art. And that's just something kids do. And then lots of them stopped doing it and I didn't stop doing it.
Beautiful. Where did you grow up?
Urbana, Illinois, where I live now.
Oh, wow.
You can go home.
It's not the same. It is not the same. I am not the same.
Right.
But I was gone for 23 years and I came back a little over 10 years ago and here I am.
Wow. I'm on a similar journey, not to take away from this conversation, but I'd like to return home to Jamaica. I haven't been there for so long. So it'll be interesting to kind of be rebirthed into this, you know, this homeland. Like you said, I'm not the same, you know, so I'm a bigger girl. I ain't that little girl anymore. You know what I'm saying?
Oh, yeah. And I'm sure your place has changed a lot too.
Oh yeah. So about, you know, we were, you know, again, thank you for being on our show. And you being such I can feel your energy. You had a very powerful perspective on how the landscape, especially contributing to your movie, how women have been just kind of pushed to the side. Where'd you get this idea from? And like, because it's just magical how it just comes across on the screen, just so beautifully. Where'd you get that idea from?
Okay, so you're talking about Seder-Masochism.
Yes,
you know that. So I have another film that I made before Seder-Masochism called Sita Sings the Blues, but we're specifically talking about Seder-Masochism. So yeah, I mean, I grew up in the 70s. I was born in 1968. And sure, feminism was a thing. And then I got a little bit older and wasn't really into feminism first because all of these feminism could mean anything. There's a lot of things that were called feminists that I didn't relate to. And the other thing was I was a horny young woman, very much attracted to like sex positive feminism, which is really at odds with radical feminism, which is what I'm more into now. Anyway, I was a lot more into pleasing men and making myself, trying to make myself not scary. It never worked, but now I'm, you know, now I'm in menopause, so I'm embracing.
Wow! Yes, scary, you have a new T-shirt to celebrate it.
Yes,
exactly. Yes, that's coming next week.
It's a menopause fabulous. Shirt.
Yeah, so when I was working on Seder-Masochism, so I started that project for a couple reasons. One is people complaining about Sita Sings the Blues were saying that I should, you know, how would you like it if someone did something like that about your religion? And it's like, well, I don't really have religion, but I mean, technically it's Judaism, right?
And
there was sort of this idea that like you should only work with cultural material that matches your genetic inheritance, which I am quite critical of. I mean, I understand there are sometimes things that seem just blatantly appropriative and exploitative, and I understand anger about that, but I think it's led to people just seeing every kind of cultural mixing as appropriation, and that's just not,
it's too
what's
much
going on.
We agree, and I've seen Sita Sings the Blues 1,000 times. I can't get enough of it, and everybody watching this, I'm gonna have a link in the undercarriage, as we call it, to go and see it, because it is groundbreaking on so many levels. Not only, I think, you elevate the stories that many people in the West have never heard, and you're doing it from a perspective, not only a personal perspective, tying in your own journey at that time, telling your story, making it personal, but also bringing in East Indian voices to talk about the story itself, right? And so I thought it was a beautiful blending of cultures, not appropriation of culture. I thought it was genius. And because this is a classic film exploration and its effect on culture and on personal development, I want to talk a little bit about Sita, even before we get into Seder-Masochism, because I really want, I'm Jewish too. I want to get into that.
Yeah.
What inspired you to choose that story and to mesh it and to bring in classic 1920s music?
Okay, so the deal is I went to Trivandrum in 2002 following my husband there, and that relationship is depicted in the movie. So,
yes,
so many people asked me why I was working with the Ramayana, and they were the story that brought me to it seemed important. So I just put that in the movie. I didn't want to keep having to talk about it. I'm like, okay, people care. Like, what is this white woman? They think I'm a white Christian woman. What is this white American Jewish woman doing there? But my husband got a job and relationship tanked there. And while I was there, while it was tanking, I was exposed to Ramayana comic books, the Amar Chitra Katha comic books. And I was fascinated by the character of Sita. Initially, I very much disliked her. I thought she was a doormat. I thought she was the epitome of what women should not aspire to. And I read as many English Ramayanas as I could. And then I went to New York on a business trip. My husband dumped me by email. I briefly went back to San Francisco and realized I wanted to take a geographic cure. So a friend of mine in New York was going to England, and he sublet me his apartment. So then I was in New York reading Ramayanas and being exposed to Annette Hanshaw for the first time through a friend of mine who ended up giving me a whole Canadian CD of Annette Hanshaw songs, because nobody had published an Annette Hanshaw CD in the US because of copyright things. I mean, we're not going to have time to get into all of this.
No,
So I was just obsessed with that CD, and I was obsessed with Annette Hanshaw, and I was obsessed with the Ramayana, and it took a couple months for me to go like, oh, let's put them together. And I did.
Was that scary? Was that scary to put your own story, especially one so...
No, that aspect wasn't scary because I was just wandering around weeping and telling everybody how miserable and heartbroken I was. One of the reasons I made the film, it turns out people don't have unlimited patience for hearing you moan about your heartbreak. And so I had to direct that energy into the movie because it was not, my heartbreak was not going away. And right, I was like, how, you know, why am I still so upset about this and, you know, so miserable? But I got to say, making the movie, which took 5 years, it's like five I years. Was all better by the end of it. I felt like all that stuff completely, you know, burned out. Like if people ask me, I have like no feelings or whatever about my ex-husband at this point. You can mention him, whatever. And I, you know, there was a time when I'd be like, it's completely clear.
Did he ever
now.
Reach out to you about it? That he was like, no, you shouldn't tell the story? Or
no.
He never pushed back on it.
That's no, he knew I was doing it. And I think he was worried that it was going to be a lot worse than it was. And when he saw the almost finished work in progress, at a screening in San Francisco, he told a friend of mine that he was relieved. So,
hey, can't ask for better than that.
But I tried to minimize him, you know, like I didn't, all I wanted to say was that he, you know, pushed me away, that he sort of dropped me, and I didn't really put in a lot of details about.
No, he's not the focus of the story at all, which I appreciated.
That's, you know, I was sorry about that. Sometimes it's I can hear you, but it's kind of a delayed. So, so I apologize.
We're just having technical issues this one.
But it's good. Delay is good. It gives me time to kind of think and take in everything you're saying. When I looking, you know, watching your movies, and getting a totally different perspective on how you view life. I love the view that you have. Why did you choose movie making to be that that healing tool? Because for me, you know, singing is something that as soon as I get mad, I'm like, I'm singing songs. I'm singing songs. Why movie making? Because it's a lot of layers to movie making. It's not just like, okay, shot, I'm good. We got the picture.
Let's say animated films.
Animated, yeah. Why animation? Why animation?
That's a good question. I mean, I liked drawing. I liked comics. I liked animation. The leap was making an animated feature film as opposed to short films. Right. And I had no ambitions to make a feature film. I didn't really want to do that, but it was specifically Sita Sings the Blues. And it was specifically this pain I was carrying around from this breakup that I wanted to deal with some way. And it just was not going away from therapy or talking to people or, you know, dating other people. It was not going away. So I thought, you know, I have skills in this medium. I know how to make animation. Why not try to tell a whole story instead of just a little piece of it? And I did. And of course, the first thing I was encouraged to worry about was the music. And I worried about it seriously for 2 weeks. And then I realized, you know, and the advice was, well, don't use old music. And then I went, you know what? You know what? I'm doing this to heal myself, and it has to be this music. So I'm going to use that music because that's the music that it has to be. Yeah. Otherwise, there's no point.
You cannot talk to Nina Paley without talking about copyright, because it has been your such a banner cause in your career in terms of fighting it and trying to erase it.
Well, I can't erase it. No, I mean, you never know. I'm very clear that anybody that likes copyright, I'm not going to get in their way. By all means, copyright the heck out of all your stuff. You just enjoy your copyrights.
Own it.
But I'm not going to anymore. And I, of course, I can't change the world. I can't reform or abolish copyright. I call myself a copyright abolitionist.
Yes.
Not because I can abolish copyright. I can't.
Right.
But because that makes my position is that we don't need copyright, that I think the world would be better without copyright. So I'm a copyright abolitionist. It's not going to happen.
You changed my artistic life. I'm a theater artist. And in Gloucester, Massachusetts, in 2010 or 11, I founded a folkloric theater company to tell stories that are otherwise dying with the people that carry them through theater. And before, or it was kind of simultaneously as I was founding the company, the folklore theater company, that's when I saw Sita. And I started hearing your message about what you were just saying. And it inspired me because these stories, I don't own these stories. I'm inspired by these stories. And these stories dropped from the lips of the people that experienced them. And they were passing them on to me, of all people, this, you know, gay Jew from, you know, from nowhere showing up on the island of Gloucester, Massachusetts. I didn't know a soul when I showed up there. And I said, tell me your stories. And they did. And I had 10 years of, we produced 40 original productions in 7 years, all based on local stories. And out the gate, because of you, I was a copyright-free company. I didn't own these stories. The people that lived them did. I'm just interpreting them in my artistic way. And so thank you for that, because you did change a world. Maybe not the whole world.
One world.
One world was rocked, you know, and inspired by your message and empowered by your message. That's why I say you're my Shiro, because I really believe that not only elevating art, and you're a solo artist. See, I'm a collaborative artist, so there's a little bit of a difference, I think, in the approach. Do you think there's a difference in the approach to the work?
Sure. Yeah. I mean, it's
in creating the work.
Sure. I mean, I'm seldom real collaborative. I actually did collaborate more than I thought I was capable of on Sita, because I had to work with actors and musicians and stuff like that. That ended up working really well. I had really awesome collaborators on that. I miss them sometimes. I see pictures from that time and I'm like, oh, I love them all.
Are you thinking about future projects that you could bring them back for?
No. Oh gosh.
Reunion?
No. I mean, it was for the project. Like, I feel like Sita wanted to be made. Yeah. And, you know, I made sure the film got made, but I really felt like it was the film that wanted to exist. And and all the collaborators came together because of that. And it was a special time and place, and it's done, and people have moved on, including myself. And I am not called that way.
It's still a hit. It's still a hit. I still come across people who talk about it.
I love it, but it's like, I'm not a, it's done.
It's a classic. It's
done. Especially. I'm loving this, and I'm sitting on the outside going, I was brought up on copywriting. This is where I'm jumping on.
Yeah.
I'm like, wait, you know, I'm, cause you know, I remember, cause I'm a writer. I write, you know, my music, I write my stories. I'm like, And I've never heard the other side of it, you know, bringing the Nita. So you all talking, I'm like, and I'm still running my hand. I'm like, what, copyright? Wait a minute.
It's a tough one. And so we've all been raised on copyright, right? Like it takes a major crisis to examine it deeply. And I mean, that's part of, you know, me walking around being copyright abolitionist. It's like most people, you know, they don't have a problem. They don't care. Here, I'll share my position here in a little song, and then we can move on to another topic.
Awesome.
Copying is not theft. Stealing a thing leaves one less left. Copying it makes one thing more. That's what copying's for. Copying is not theft. If I copy yours, you have it too. One for me and one for you. That's what copies can do. If I steal your bicycle, you have to take the bus. But if I just copy it, there's one for each of us. Making more of a thing. That is what we call copying. Sharing ideas with everyone. That's why copying is fun.
And that highlights your humor. You have a great way of getting your humor across in the animations that you do, even just here speaking to you. It would take only a minute to know that you have a sense of humor about life, and that's what makes your movie making so wonderful. Your animation's so easy to just sit back and enjoy it. You know, because as soon as Henry brought me to the movie, he said, you know, you've got to see this movie. I'm like, man, what's this movie about? Sita's mad, you know, because I'm like, Sita's mad. It's a Jewish movie. Well, he's kind of Jewish. He has a little bit. I'm like, well, what am I going to expect? And as soon as I sat down, I was laughing because you have a way of getting the message across, even though serious and very, you know, it's like just spoonful of sugar. So, you know, it shows to your sense of humor, and you've got to have a sense of humor when you're dealing with issues that are so prevalent in society and that need to be addressed. So I want to say thank you for that.
Well, you're welcome, and thank you.
Because a good laugh is something that has saved my life. And I talk about this with Henry that, you know, it's people like you who step out of the box to creating something very different and allowing me to go on the journey with you from seeing the perspective of how you saw, you know, women and how women have been marginalized and how everything has just been changed. And I loved how you brought that back. So thank you again. What I wanted to ask you, I know I'm just rambling on because I'm excited. I wanted to say is, where did you get that platform to inject humor into your storytelling?
Oh, they've never been separable. Right. I mean, humor is not like a separate thing, right? It's not like a spice that you shake on something.
Right.
It's for, if I'm being honest, I'm probably going to be funny. It's, it would be dishonest to deny the humor that I see in things, but yeah, it's not like you just add it, you know, it's literally my take. And you know, the more, it's very bound up in pain. Humor.
Yeah, I mean, there's something about it. if you don't laugh, you're gonna cry. You know,
sure. and you can do both. It's like you can do both.
You learn that the hard way.
Do both, and I do do both. I mean, with Seder-Masochism, with the opening, it sort of took me aback, not in a negative way, but I grew up in a conservative Jewish family. And it was very patriarchal in some ways when it came to the religious teaching.
Excuse me.
Bless you.
When it came, so sorry.
When it came to religion,
you should live a long life.
Mazel tov.
Mazel tov. We're going to give you a bar mitzvah. Stop it. You're now an official Jew. You went, yeah.
Correct. It's about time. Yes.
The religious teachings came from the men, and I didn't feel that they elevated the women in the stories at all. Even when you watch the 1950, what is it, 55 Ten Commandments with Charlton Heston and
yes, a very famous feminist film, that one.
Yes. Yes. Does not elevate the state of women in a feminist light at all. But it was a product of its time. And, you know, you talk about appropriation and the criticism of cultural appropriation. My grandmother, God rest her soul, born Yetta, changed her name to Elaine. Not Elaine, Elaine, because you got to really pierce it in. She used to point to this little patch of melanin on my elbow, and she'd say, "You know what, honey? That's what's left of your Africa."
That's what's left of your what?
Of your Africa.
Of your Africa?
Yes. And what she meant was humanity was born out of Africa. Hmm. And that we all share that as a foundation. And so what was really striking to me about, I mean, it's threaded all the way through Seder-Masochism, but the opening of the birth, the mother of all of us, was really profoundly beautiful. Why did you start it that way, that story?
Right. So I had decided I was going to do something about Passover because I needed to work on my father, right? Like, who had died. He died a few months after I did that interview in the movie. Wow. But I didn't know where that interview was going to go or how I was going to use it. I just got an interview with him and I was like, yeah, I'll do something about Passover that will satisfy these critics that say that I should only do something about, you know, my racial cultural inheritance. But I didn't really know the point of it. So I just started by learning more about Passover, reading the book of Exodus, because Passover is about telling the story of Exodus. It's not really. It's telling a highly edited story of Exodus. So when I actually read Exodus, there was a lot in Exodus that they never said. They never told us about. And I, you know, but anyway, I could at least make these musical numbers about Moses and Exodus. But then I had like half a film and I was like, well, what's the point? I mean, I don't really relate to Moses. He's not the hero in my world. And what's going on? So of course I read tons of commentaries about Exodus. And my favorite one was called, I think it was called When God Was a Woman.
Sounds familiar.
Maybe that's the one. I have it written down. I have a terrible memory. But there was this thesis that the story of Exodus was, the subtext of it was that it was the end of goddess worship. That, you know, that there's only one God, right? Thou shalt have no other gods before me. Also means goddesses. There's one God and that God is male. And that emerged in a region where goddess worship was very common. The gods that were, I mean, male gods were ascendant. Male gods were becoming more and more popular and powerful in relation to the female goddesses, but still goddess worship remained. And then you had this rules like, nope, no more goddess worship. Those are idols. Those are forbidden. And I liked this interpretation. It stuck with me. It's a flawed book, but that was the angle that stuck with me. And so I was just like, okay, if that's what Exodus is about the end of the goddess, then I'm going to have to attempt to recreate the goddess who we've lost. And that means I'm going to have to just try my best to sort of make her up.
And, well, and make her the golden calf. I mean, yes. that was so striking and unexpected, because I was always under the impression it was a bull, right?
Maybe, but that was the way I could connect it to Hathor, right? So Hathor, yes. The cow goddess, is really popular Egyptian goddess. And perfect. I just had endless time to think about, to think about all sorts of things, right? Like, mm-hmm. So there's a commandment that says, thou shalt not make images.
Yeah.
So choosing a artistic style for the movie was like, how am I going to do that? But I was like, okay, the nation of Israel emerged between the nations of Egypt and Assyria. And so they have great art. Ancient art.
Yeah.
And so I went to that as my visual inspiration. But, you know, I was making all these Egyptian hieroglyphics and animating them.
Follow the bouncing.
Yeah. And I thought about this no graven images thing, and I went like, wait a minute. Maybe this is a prohibition against hieroglyphics. That, you know, the Semitic language, they were, so one thing about like the Judaism or Abrahamism, I guess at that time, is it was super abstract, right? Like you're not supposed to visualize, you're not supposed to make images, but the word is really important. And they had like an abstract alphabet.
Yeah.
Whereas, the Egyptian stuff is all these hieroglyphics, which is exactly what they mention in the prohibition against images. You know, nothing that crawls upon the earth, nothing that flies in the sky, no man, no woman. And I'm like, wait a minute, all these things.
Hieroglyphics. Yeah.
Yeah. And anyway, wow. Just as I'm babbling along, throw me another question.
Genius, though. It's genius because the way you interpreted it is accessible. It's accessible to Egyptians. It's accessible to Jews. It's accessible to Christians. And it's so powerful, the imagery, with that, your humor threading all the way through.
You know? Another thing that I thought about was like the death of the firstborn Egyptians. And Exodus in general, I realized that there was a parallel Exodus of Egyptian firstborns into the afterworld. Like they had their system of thought, their religion. And if you take the story at its word that God was communicating with the Hebrews while, you know, in the heart of Egypt, then it's like, well, the Egyptians had their own thing going on. And what was that? And I wanted to do that justice. They had like their journey to the afterlife and what that meant. And it was a kind of exodus of firstborns. And it was an exodus of a lot of things, right? It was an exodus of humanity from the mother, from the great mother.
Compassion, an exodus of a lot of things. Oh, yeah. You know, I noticed how, you know, you, when we first started, we were having sound issues, and I noticing this big mic. This is how I listen to the conversation, and then I just pick out things I want to ask you. So this is what I'm going to do.
Do it.
How did you get into podcasting? You got this huge, you got all the equipment, you got the juice. How did you get
You've got the biggest phallus.
That's the biggest mic I've ever seen.
All right. I bought this mic when I started podcasting. So I do a podcast called Heterodorks.
Right. Yes, I've heard it. It's great.
With so Corinna Cohn, who is a transsexual.
Nice.
And I have been canceled because I insist that humans, like other mammals, cannot change sex. And I have no animosity towards people who cross-dress, you know, men that want to wear dresses or whatever. I don't even care how people identify themselves, but I draw the line at them forcing me to identify them in a certain way. So it's fine with me if a man identifies as a woman, but he cannot make me identify him as a woman.
All right, the conversation is now taking a turn. I'm loving this. This is something, baby.
Here we go.
Anyway, anyway, so Corinna.
I'm waiting for that animation.
Corinna is a dear friend. And the other thing is that, like, you know, people are like, oh, you're transphobic. It's like, really?
No.
I've had two boyfriends who were trans, right? Like,
and
I know that they're men because, you know, we got naked and we did stuff and I'm heterosexual and so were they. So, but you know, they're still trans identified. Fine. Right. Anyway, Corinna is post-surgical transsexual and just a wonderful human being, and we became friends in the midst of all of this, and it was Corinna's idea that we should do a podcast, and so we just started doing it. And yeah, heterodorks.com. It's heterodorx.com. And you can listen to a TERF and a tranny talking to all kinds of people. I'm the TERF, he's the tranny.
Beautiful.
It's a delicious dish. What a delicious TERF tranny. I love it. I love it. I love it.
Yeah, we started the TERF tranny alliance.
That's great. Okay. It's just I love the name TERF tranny. I love it. I just love that. Okay, so you get up in the morning, Nina, and your life, because you know a lot of people say, you know, oh, she probably has a special life. This is why she does it. She's got what's a day in the life of you? Like, you get up in the morning, what does your day look like? When you know you get out, you go, when you get your inspiration come, shit like that. What do you do?
Okay, well, I'm a creature of the seasons. In the summer, I wake up, my cats are usually there, I pet the cats. If I am exhibiting poor discipline, I will lay in bed and fiddle through my phone for like an hour because I'm addicted and sick like everybody else. If I've had some discipline, I will have put my phone in the other room and I will not touch it until I get up. Okay. If it's the summer, there's a good chance I'm going to go for a bike ride.
Oh, hence, you're a bike rider. Okay.
Yeah, that's why I'm tired today, is because I rode 103 miles today.
God, is that a normal thing for you to get up on your bike and say, yeah, I'm going 103 it's miles like, that way?
I'll do a 100-mile ride maybe once a week in the summer.
Okay.
It's pretty crazy though. Like it's a pretty obsessive behavior. I rode 8,000 miles last year. I rode 8,000 miles the year before. I'm pushing 6,000 miles this year. We'll see. I shouldn't make myself go to 8,000 if I'm not enjoying it.
And you have the coolest bike too.
Yes. I'm a recumbent bicycle collector.
Really cool.
So they're comfy bikes. Yeah, but anyway, in the summer, that's a lot of what I do. It's like I get to be outside and do that. It fills time. Now in the winter, I don't do that. I feel totally different. I hibernate like a bear. I probably gain 10 pounds. it's just natural. It's like, you know, it's a fine thing to do. I've tried exercising through the winter and I don't like it. My body doesn't like it. And so it's like, okay, this is the time we go inward. And last year I made apocalypseanimated.com, which is I illustrated the Book of Revelation with close to 300 animated GIFs. And that was the perfect thing to do in the hibernation phase. And
so cool.
Is not too different from the bicycling in that you just like, you just go, you're just, I mean, bicycling has taught me to just go and keep going and don't be a whiner. Just go and then
go
for a long, you know, get in this meditative state and just do the thing. And that's what I did last year. This year, I am not sure what my big hibernation project is going to be. It might be a comic book, which I haven't done for 20 some years.
Very cool.
But it might be because I thought of a superhero idea.
20 some years. You're looking good, girl. That's what you mean. How do you keep your movie physique? Your movie creator physique. You're looking good, but you said 20 something. I'm like, how old is she? How old are you, girl? You don't got to tell me, but I'm telling you. 2008, wasn't it?
I'm 54. Thank you.
You look good, girl. Your bike riding, movie making looks good on you, man.
Now you're making me feel old. I'm 56.
Well, you're older than me. See?
I am.
I'm going to look just like you in 2 years. Be, have a beard hormone. And be bald.
Bald.
Yeah. Yeah.
Exactly. You know, you were talking about your apocalypse project, and one of the things I love about you is that you really bring your audiences into your process. Yeah. You show every step of the way. You show how you do what you do. And a lot of that you can find on your websites. And I found your apocalypse thing because I'm a Patreon supporter.
Thank you. Oh my gosh. Thank you. I am so, that's another thing. When I wake up almost every day, I think, even though they're not hearing it telepathically, but I think like, I am so grateful that people send me money.
We're not there yet. We're not a Patreon yet, but we will. And, you know,
we'll talk.
But I downloaded the images that you could play with to create your own sort of mythological.
Oh, that was Mystic Symbolic.
Mystic Symbolic, yes.
Yeah, that's another project. That was from 2 years ago.
Oh, I thought it was all part of the same.
No, and that's one that, so that I worked with, come on, brain. His name's not coming to me. I worked with this brilliant coder who set that up, who's busy now. But yeah, that's a weird one. MysticSymbolic.com, I think, if anyone wants to play with that. That is that's its own thing.
It was so fun.
Well, that's discovery for me. What is this? Tell me. What is this Mystic Symbolic? What is this? What's the premise of this website? Tell me.
What did I call it? It's some kind of art generator. Right. Has nothing to do with AI.
Okay.
Nothing whatsoever to do with AI. It just combines symbols in what I hope is some sort of attractive way. You know, now that you know about these AI artists.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah, that all started this year, and that's like, that's pretty weird for me as an artist. I don't feel like it's replacing me or making me obsolete, but that some very nice images come out of these things. And it's really, I don't want to say this is like a problem, but it raises real existential questions.
Well, I was going to ask you, does it push you to go further outside your comfort zone or to keep developing your art?
No, I mean, it doesn't do anything like that. I don't, I don't know. I haven't come to any resolution about it, but it's a big deal. Like, that is a good, like, it just changes. It's just like, it changes. It's a game changer. And I don't know how exactly. I don't know. I can't tell you what is happening, but yeah. Something, clearly something big is happening, has happened, as evidenced by these artificial intelligence art generators. And that's all I can say is like big, and I'll maybe in a couple of years, I'll have a hot take.
About somebody from biblical times, let's call it, looking at your work, you know, somebody who was looking and carving hieroglyphs, looking at your work today, they might have the same kind of reaction.
Oh yeah, we've made incredible. I mean, art is not what it was. The digital revolution, all my animation, you know, like being a solo animator was not possible 20 years ago. Yeah, no. I mean, in terms of making a feature film, you could be a solo animator, but like when I made Sita Sings the Blues, it was groundbreaking at the time, but only because of the coincidence of the technology that allowed me to do that.
Also the geometric quality of your work.
Which had to do with the technology, right? Yeah. Like I, you know, I made it in Macromedia Flash, vector-based program. I started it on a laptop. There were various memory constraints. And so I worked with the tools that I had. Right. And that had a lot to do with the style that I used.
Yeah.
It Can wasn't you, that I had the style and then I found the software for it. It was like, no, I like had, you know, this laptop and this software, and it's like, okay, that's going to determine what the stuff looks like.
Can you actually draw also, you know, pen, paper back the old school way? Can you do that too? How long have you been doing that?
Well, I mean, since I was a kid, since I was very little.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay,
I still draw on paper sometimes. Yeah. And if I do this comic book, it's probably going to be on paper. It's so old school now.
Yeah,
right?
Old school. Yeah. Yes, I know.
That's how I do it. And then you also do textile art now.
That's true. Well, that was more of a phase. We still have the machine. We still have the studio, but I was obsessively making art quilts for a period of time then because I needed to do something that wasn't animation. And the way I got back into animation was I tricked myself on purpose by investing everything in the art quilt stuff. So I knew that like the burden of it would make me want to escape that.
And are those still available? Going back to animation.
Yes. Oh yes. That's Pale Gray Labs. PaleGrayLabs.com, because it's a collaboration with Theodore Gray, who is a noted chemistry popularizer and a very interesting character himself.
They're so cool.
Who are your mentors? Like people who you looked up to from when it comes to animation? You know, those anybody who stands out in your mind, go, yeah, that's why I became, or that it came be part of your road to animation. Anybody that stands out for you?
Well, there was this book called The Animation Book by Kit Laybourne. Right. And on the cover, it had these beautiful drawings that I just found. They were just exquisite. And they were by George Griffin. And when I moved to New York, I met George Griffin. That was part of my amazing experience of moving to New York. It's like, I am friends with this person that drew the stuff on the book that I was obsessed with when I was 13 years old, and I'm talking to him and he's a real guy. There were a lot of experiences like that in New York, but you know, mentors, more like, I mean, inspirations. It's not like I I dated a guy in San Francisco who was an animator, and he had an animation desk, which I had never encountered before. So using his animation desk was a real treat. I suppose that was sort of mentoring.
Right.
And, but mostly it's inspiration and, you know, Fleischer Brothers, all the stuff. It's like, you know, I was exposed to everything.
Well, your copying It's Not Theft video is right out of the Fleischer canon. I mean, it's beautiful. And it's, you know, getting back to this whole concept of classic, right? Classic animation. What was your go-to? Who was your classic animation guru in a way?
No one was teaching me directly.
But like Saturday morning cartoons?
PBS had a show of European art animation, and I loved that stuff. Mm-hmm. And I would say Bruno Bozzetto.
Oh, Bruno, I'll write that down.
Yeah, it's Bozzetto or ETO.
Okay.
He directed a film called Allegro Non Troppo, which was a parody of Fantasia.
Yes,
that, to my mind, was better than Fantasia. I loved that so much. Oh, also Yellow Submarine.
Oh,
huge influence.
I can see that.
Okay. Yellow Submarine.
That's got fantastic, amazing design. They played it on TV at least once a year when I was growing up, and when I was teaching at Parsons, which would have been like 2003, 2004, 2005. I had students that hadn't even heard of it. They'd never seen it.
I know.
And that's because of copyright. That's because they clamped down on it. They realized that they had a valuable property and they dealt with it by making it inaccessible. And so there's a whole generation that hasn't seen it.
Well, and you've talked a lot in your TED talk. You talked about how nobody asked us what they were going to put into our heads, what we were going to be, was going to be forced upon us. All the Christmas music and the Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer stop motion stuff. And, you know, I think that really hit me as an artist, thinking, now it's, we have a choice. We can not go see it, or we can turn the channel, right? Or go to another website. But it wasn't so easy back then when we were kids.
Yeah.
To get away from it.
You know, I did not collect records or CDs. I was not a music collector. And yet I have memorized tons of music. And that's all ambient music. That's all from like going into stores where they're playing stuff, going to
radio
houses. So you don't have to, you know, I had no control over that. It's just, I recognize a whole bunch of things and I can sing along to a whole bunch of things. And I could not tell you where I first heard these things.
Yeah. Same as me. I think I said this to Henry that once it comes to music, you know, I'll listen to the radio and I can tell you what year it came on. I can tell you, but I don't know. I don't have any of this stuff. It was just something like, it dates my life. If you put on a certain, you know, song, Sailing, I can tell you where I was. I was sitting around the table eating, you know.
And I know that song. The thing is, I'm hearing the entire god-awful song, which I would never seek out.
Yes, exactly. I was eating sugar comb when I was, you know, listening to that song on the radio. So, I totally get it. And I see the copyright, the idea of it, you know. But yeah, music has always been something important to me. And your music, the choice of music you've chosen, because I'm telling you straight up, I ain't gonna lie to you, I haven't seen Sing the Blues. I've seen Seder-Masochism already, but I haven't seen the other one. And the music you've chosen for that, I was in awe. Like, I mean, when I heard you, Henry was there because we watched together, Free to Be You and Me. I was like, oh, Free to Be You and Me. Oh, I remember that. And I was like dying.
is one of the ways that you just capture people's heart in movies as well, to take them along on that journey. So I love the movie, the music selection. How do you come up with the music for your movies? Do people weigh in on it, or you just remember, you go, hey, I remember that song, I'm putting it in there?
It's a mix, but I do want to talk about Free to Be You and Me.
Okay.
Right. So that is a loaded song because it was part of our childhoods, right? Like it was, it was from a really liberal time, and it promised, we were being
groomed, the generation.
Yes. we were all, but it was good. Right? Like I like that. We were, you know, we were the young people that were, you know, gonna carry out these ideals of egalitarianism, and it was really good stuff.
Right.
So the weight of that music does not entirely come from the music. It comes from us. It comes from our generation and how we as children related to that. So it has a kind of cultural weight and cultural meaning that is very much tied to that and tied to us. It's not just, you know, a pretty song. So when I used it in that film, that cultural weight adds to the story, because it's the Exodus, right? It's this promised land, the promise of the promised land, just as we were promised this egalitarian future that we were going to build. And then the last beat is they're in a desert.
Yes.
Like the last beat is like, this didn't happen. Because to us, what happened was the Reagan years.
Yeah. That's right.
Right. It was like, here's this amazing beauty. And it's like, nope.
Yeah. Unicorns and rainbows. And then
right. Like, what? It's like, wait. No, that didn't happen. And we feel that, right?
Yes.
Like
that. Oh, yes, we do.
Well, yeah, that counterpointed with this land is mine as well, in terms of really taking a hard look at the history, taking a hard look at what men have wrought throughout history to claim, to stake their claim in a piece of earth, and the expense of humanity, expense of their humanity.
And God is telling all of them that the land belongs to them.
That's right.
Yes, God, it belongs to you. It belongs to you. It's an Oprah moment. You can have a piece of land. You can have a piece right. of land.
Right. But it all comes down to the original, you know, that Mother Earth that birthed us all. And just such a profoundly beautiful and groundbreaking work that is now a classic. It really, really is a modern classic. And even though it was, what was it, 2018 that you made it, that it came out?
That I released it. Yeah, and I got canceled right around that time. So that really stunted its...
Well, I share it. I share it every Passover on YouTube, on Facebook. I share it with my dear friends, people who I care about, because I resonate with it very deeply. And incidentally, your t-shirt, if you stand up a little bit, is the angel of death from Seder-Masochism. I want that t-shirt. Yes.
You can get it from palegraylabs.com.
I know, but let me tell you, the import fees in Spain are ridiculous.
Spain,
I ordered
that's
a
right.
t-shirt from England, which is just right across the water. And it was $40.
You know import what? Fees
for a t-shirt.
Uh-oh. Yeah, that's happening. Yeah,
so you need to expand your market internationally.
Yeah.
Well, you know what? I can make this shirt available on Teespring again, and I mean, it won't be super cheap, but they do at least print them in Europe for European customers. So
you know what I'll do though?
Let me do that.
I have somebody coming to visit, so I'll buy it. I'll have it sent to him, and then he'll bring it.
Got the hook up. You got the hook up on the t-shirt.
So listen, we're wrapping up. It's been about an hour.
I want to tell people though, don't watch my movies on YouTube, or at least don't watch Seder-Masochism on YouTube, because I never posted it on YouTube. It's free culture, so other people can post it, but YouTube does not recognize fair use, and therefore YouTube silences bits of it based on their content ID machine. So the place to see it.
Why I put the archive.com or link in the marriage.
Right.
It's frustrating. Sita is not Sita. Blocked, and you can see it right. on YouTube.
You can see it any old where, but it's try to find it without commercials, because again, there are some versions where people put commercials on it. The one we watched.
Well, all I'm going to add is that Sita Sing the Blues, I'm going to be watching it tonight. I thought I was supposed to watch it today, but my mind, I don't know where my mind is. Brother Man Henry calls me and says, hey, we're going on in about a half an hour. I'm like, what?
I thought we were doing it on Monday. Instead of poster on Monday. So, no, that's what we're launching it at.
But I have no doubt that I'm going to love it just like I did your first movie, because I just love the way you present things. So I just, again, thank you for coming out and having a sense of humor and being so relaxed, and because your persona comes out so well in the music. People, you talk the talk, you walk the talk, say, you know what I mean? You do it. So who you are in that movie is really presented out here. You're just, and that's gold in this world. So thank you.
Well, thank you. Thank you both for having me. And yeah.
Go rest.
I love that.
Take it easy.
I'm gonna take it real easy now. My legs
hurt.
Thank
you for making one of my dreams come true.
Nice.
Glad to be here with us. And last thing I want to ask you is, this is a channel about classic cinema and foundational classic cinema that has still influences our culture globally and influences us personally, as we were talking about our memories from childhood. Can you give us a movie, a classic film that has stuck with you since you can remember, that we can maybe explore?
Yellow Submarine.
Yes.
Yellow Submarine.
I hope we can find it for free.
Yeah, I don't know. It's hard to find. Yellow Submarine and Allegro Non Troppo.
Oh, Allegro Non Troppo. Okay.
I recommend.
Okay.
Great. Well, we will seek them out. One of the stipulations for doing this channel is, and doing this talk show, is that all the films that we talk about are free and accessible to anyone who wants to see them.
Oh, yeah.
So, but you know what? We have ways.
Yeah, there's ways of magic. Well, we can do it. Good.
In the pockets of the internet, but you know, Daily Motion, you can find things. And sometimes they're broken up into part one, part two, you know. But thank you. Thank you for those. We'll definitely look for them.
All right.
And thank you again for your time and your heart and your talent and your voice.
Thank you so much. All right. I'm going to go pee. Bye.
Go pee.
I got to go pee too. It's in sync. I got to go pee too. I'm going to have to go.
I got to go pee three. Well, let's... We'll wrap it up here. Thank you, everybody, for listening. That was great. Was that amazing? Nina freaking Paley.
Well, yeah, this in the house, she was awesome, and you handled it so well. I just love being being a part of it. And you know, you know what is nice is when you meet someone that you've always admired or you see their work, and then you realize that they're just down to earth people just doing their thing. You know, they get up and go pee.
We all pee, honey.
We all pee.
We all pee. You know, and this is the thing, you know, she was talking about being canceled and all that stuff.
Right.
Listen, everyone has an opinion. Everyone has their way of looking at the world.
Right.
And we shouldn't cancel people just for having an opinion. And
I don't know where that came from.
In a certain way.
That's something that's a new thing. I'm not even sure where we decided we had the right or the audacity to try to dictate someone's opinion by canceling them. Like, what? When did that happen? But that's a whole nother podcast that we could talk about everything.
Exactly. We'll find a classic film about canceling in 1932 or whatever.
That doesn't make any sense to me.
Everybody who's watching us, thank you for being here. Thank you for joining us. Be a buff. Subscribe to our YouTube channel. Ring the little bell if you want to get notifications. Like our videos, because it is what it is. The algorithms like that. And we get to grow. We get to progress the more viewers we have and subscribers. And we're calling our followers buffs because we're all... movie buffs, and we
we have movie muscle buff.
We are bald. You know, someday we'll start a Patreon, and we're gonna have merch, and it's gonna say buff. We talked about having little buttons.
Buff. We're here to buff you out. Yeah, exactly. Bring it back. We're here to buff you out. Buff it out, I tell you. Yeah, I mean, I had a delight. This being our second show, I think, you know what? It's looking good. And, you know, I think we just, as I said, a great look, or you said, sorry, a great look at classic movies and how they impact us today. And, you know, and how it really sustains or takes away from our mental health. Who knows? But it's a good, this is a great space to share that. So I'm excited to see.
Be looking for Imitation of Life. I'll put a link in the undercarriage. And it's from 1934. They remade it in the 50s.
Right.
I haven't found that one yet to share. If I do, I'll add that one as well, because I think it's really important to look at the original, the OG Imitation of Life. And then the one that they remade and how they changed in those times, right? Yep. From the 30s to the 50s was 20 years. Think back 20 years to the year 2000. Can you believe
that? Isn't that crazy? The year 2000. You know what? Before you go, I met some people and I'm like, okay, you're talking about age. And they go, when were you born? 2000? I'm like, what?
Well, you should be a baby.
Anyways, we gotta get out of here. People gotta go eat. People gotta pee. People gotta pee.
All right. Thanks, everybody. See you next week on
Queen B Divine, Queen B, and Henry C. Henry C. Queen B. We're together. Let's shake hands. Put your hand there. Give me your hand. There you go.
Yay, see ya. Hey. Hands across. Whatever. Hands across the world.
Get out of here.
Watching classic screenshots, everybody. We'll see you next week.
All right. Bye-bye.
Bye.